Good evening. I want to thank you for tuning in to the Westridge Bible Study, and I hope you enjoy these studies from God's Word. Let me encourage you to go find your Bible this evening and turn to 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings chapter 18. Last week we studied in chapter 18 verses 17 through 21, and our lesson was on that main phrase, how long will you falter or waver between two opinions? And we learned that Ahab and his father, yeah, they accused Elijah of being the troublemaker, but the truth of the matter is, they were the real troublemakers. And the two major sins committed by Ahab and is found in verse 18, where we saw last week, you have forsaken, you've abandoned the word, the commandments of God, and followed Baal. So they forsook the word of God, and they followed Baal, this false god, this idol worship. They were actually serial idol worshipers. And then we dealt with that main question in verse 21, when Elijah came to all the people and said, how long do you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. And the emphasis is on follow him. But if Baal, if he's God, then follow him. And the Bible says, but the people didn't answer him a word. In other words, they just didn't respond or reply. And we saw that word falter last week means to bounce back and forth. It gives the idea of faltering or wavering. And the truth of the matter is they were wavering in their faith. They had a divided heart. The text says they had two opinions, the scripture says. And so in verse number 21, he's simply saying, hey guys, it's time to make a choice. How long? They procrastinated. How long are you going to waver back and forth? If God is God, if Jehovah is God, follow him. But if Baal's God, follow him. So we see a clear choice. And I like this because Elijah is pressing the people for a decision. And you can't worship Baal and follow the Lord God Jehovah. And the response in verse 21 was really a no response. The Bible says the people answered him, not a word. And if you remember last week, I quoted Pastor Lemming. Oh, he probably made this statement 20, 25 years ago, where he said a no decision. Well, in reality, it is a no decision. Though the people didn't respond, well, that was a response, and that was a no decision. And so the Bible says the people answered him, not a word. They didn't respond. Tonight, I want to pick up in verse number 20. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 20 through 29. And our title is found in verse 24. The God who answers by fire, he is God. That's the punchline of the story. And we're just going to look at the first section of the story because it's a rather long story, and I don't want to bore you tonight, but we'll look at the first section of the story that actually demonstrates the emptiness of idol worship, the futility of worshiping Baal. We will notice how they worship, what they did, how they prayed, and we'll see what God has to say about this first part of the story. God's going to use Elijah to physically challenge and demonstrate the weakness, the emptiness, I mean, the very weakness of Baal worship. And, you know, don't trust in idols. That's the message. And so tonight we're going to look at this first section, the emptiness of idols. Would you just pray with me just for a minute? Father, would you bless this study of your word? Lord, as we open up our Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 18, Lord, help us to read along in the story verse by verse. Help us, oh God, to make application. Lord, we're thankful this evening that we can take the scripture and apply it to our life. Lord, it's just not a history book, but it's a book that's applicable today. And the problems they had with idolatry back then, Lord, we have the same problems today. So help us to see the emptiness of idol worship. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I want you to notice, first of all, in the story, in verse number 22, I want you to notice that Elijah was in the minority. Look what the Bible says in verse 22. Then Elijah said to the people, I alone am a prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450 men. Take your pen and underline that phrase, I alone. And then the phrase, Baal's prophets are 450 men. In other words, it was one against 450. In fact, it was one against the nation of Israel because they were standing or sitting on the fence. They were somehow, you know, worshiping Jehovah with Baal worship, and they were just kind of split in their decision. And I want you to notice that Elijah was in the minority. When you look at verse 25, the Bible says, then Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose one bull for yourselves and prepare it first. Notice, underline this next phrase, for you are many. There were many standing with the idol Baal, but only Elijah was standing alone against this false god and the prophets of Baal, and the people of Israel who were straddling the fence, one foot in the church house, one foot in the world, worshiping Baal. Elijah was in the minority. There's a few things we can learn here, and I want to make this very, very applicable. Three lessons. Lesson number one, did you know that following God can be a lonely pursuit? As we study the life of Elijah, he spent a lot of time alone. For instance, when he comes on the scene in First Kings chapter 17 and in verse number 1, when he just appears on the scene, his first 6 months, he was alone at the brook of Kereth. And then for 3 years, he spends a lot of time alone with the widow and the widow's son. For 3 years, he was a lonely man. And anytime you follow God, it can be a lonely pursuit. Did you notice that there's times in the life of Elijah, when we get over into chapter 19, that he was lonely even to the point of depression? Did you know that Elijah even prayed for the Lord to take him, and he was contemplating suicide because he was so very lonely? But the Bible says that an angel of the Lord came and touched him, and God did a special work in his life. My point is, as you study the Word of God, yeah, there's a great lesson here. If you follow the Lord, sometimes you're going to be lonely. David Jeremiah said this about Elijah. He said, you have one man versus the entire world. And that's true. And so Elijah was feeling kind of lonely. And then notice there was a second lesson. Notice there was a great crowd following Baal. By the way, let me just make emphasis here. Just because everybody is following Baal or everybody is doing it, look, that doesn't make it right. I think sometimes we make our decisions on right, on wrong, and who's doing it? If the majority is doing it, certainly it must be right. No, on the contrary. Here we see that there was a great crowd following Baal. Elijah was in the minority. And then we notice that this crowd went the way of the world. Did you know that Christianity and worldliness oppose each other? Stop and think with me. In Christianity, very seldom do we talk about biblical separation. Very seldom do we talk about worldliness. Well, Israel was riding the fence. Maybe some of you have read the story of Michael Jordan. You know, Michael Jordan, probably the most famous basketball player in the world. In his book, Driven Within, Jordan tells the story of going to a friend's home and having dinner with his friend. This friend was the CEO of another NBA basketball team, and his name was Whitfield. They were going out to eat that night. Jordan came in and said, "Look, I'm cold. Do you have a jacket that I could borrow?" And Whitfield said, "Yeah, you go down the hallway and open up the closet. There's all kinds of jackets." And Jordan went in and he pulled out a jacket and he looked and it said Puma. He pulled out another jacket and it said Puma. He pulled out another jacket and it said Puma. And he pulled out, I mean, just a load of jackets with Puma. He walked back in and looked at Whitfield. And he just dropped the bundle of jackets that said Puma, and Jordan went into the kitchen and found a pair of scissors. He walked back into where Whitfield was, and he began to cut those jackets and the brand name Puma. He found one jacket that said Nike. Well, Whitfield was good friends with Ralph Sampson, and Ralph Sampson marketed Puma. And of course, Michael Jordan has made the Nike Swish famous. So Jordan put his jacket, this Nike jacket on, and he looked at Whitfield and he made this statement, a very famous statement: "You cannot ride the fence." And I think that's what we try to do as Christians. You know, we want to wear Puma when God wants us to follow Nike. We want to follow Baal when God wants us to follow Jehovah. We try riding the fence, or we try to straddle the fence. Can I share with you some verses that I read this morning that are still fresh in my heart and still spoke to my heart? Actually, my heart was smitten again through the conviction of the Word of God. This morning I read through the book of James. James says this: "You adulterers and adulteresses, know you not that friendship with the world," friendship with Baal, "is enmity with God?" Now notice, this phrase really struck me. "Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself," notice, "wants to be a friend, makes himself an enemy of God." Wow, that is a powerful verse on this matter of worldliness. The question is, do you want to be a friend of the world? And do you make yourself a friend of the world? When you make yourself a friend of the world, and you ride the fence, so to speak, James 4:4 says, you're making yourself an enemy of God. And then when I finished the book of James this morning, I read through 1 Peter and 2 Peter. Here's what 1 Peter says. These are verses that really struck my heart this morning, and I added them to the Bible study. In 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 3, here's what Peter says: "We've spent enough of our lifetime." our past lifetime in doing the will of the Gentiles, how we lived before we were saved. Notice, when we walked in lewdness, lust, drunkenness, revelries. Did you see that? Revelries. Drinking parties. And then this phrase, abominable idolatries. In regard to these, Peter says, they, the Gentiles, the world, they think it's strange that you do not run with them. That is separation from the world. You do not run with them to the same excess of debauchery. They were even having drinking parties. They were seeing who could drink as much alcohol, and whoever drank the most alcohol won the contest. By the way, we do that today in modern society. That's spoken of in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. Yeah, if you follow God, you're going to be in the minority. Elijah was. If you follow God, you can't straddle the fence. Elijah was on God's side, but the nation of Israel, they were straddling the fence. And then lesson number 3, hey guys, did you know that idol worship is very popular? Very, very popular. By the way, an idol is anything that competes or contends or rivals our love for God. The question is, what do you love more than God? Think of it. What about popularity? Oh my, do you realize it is some people's supreme goal in life to make a name for themselves? They are so consumed with popularity. That's an idol. What about sports? And certainly we're living in a day where we're living without sports because of the pandemic. And today people are going through withdrawals because of sports. What about money? What about possessions? What about cars? What about material things? Listen to another passage that I read this morning. In 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse number 1, the Bible says, but know this, I want you to know something, that in the last days, perilous times, by the way, that phrase, perilous times, can be translated times of stress, yeah? Times of stress will come, for men will be lovers of themselves, number one, lovers of money, number two, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parent. Think of the rebellion. Unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers. And then he gets down to verse number 4, and he says, notice, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. That is idolatry. Yeah, it might be the popular thing to do. Idol worship is very popular. Pride is very popular. But we need to understand that an idol is anything that competes and contends or even rivals with our love for God. Well, first of all, our first point in the lesson this morning is that Elijah was certainly in the minority. But then second in the story, as we proceed in verse 23, this is actually a battle for supremacy. Literally, the battles of the gods. The showdown between God and Baal. If God is God, follow him. If Baal is God, follow him. And the God who answers by fire, he is God, Elijah says. So here we have this battle for supremacy. But notice verse 23 and verse number 24. Here's the challenge of Elijah. Elijah says, let them give us 2 bulls. let them choose one bull for themselves, or maybe the King James bullock, but it was a bull. Cut it in pieces. Lay it out on the wood, this wooden altar. Don't put any fire under it. Elijah said, I'll prepare the other bull, and I'll lay it on the wood also, and I won't put any fire under it. Now here's verse 24, the battle for supremacy. Then you call on the name of your gods, and I will call on the name of the Lord. You call on your gods, I'll call on my God, the name of the Lord. And the God who answers by fire, he says in verse 24, he is God. You know that little phrase, the God who answers by fire. There's been a lot written on that little phrase, he is God, because Baal was worshipped as the god of the sun, which is deemed the fire of the universe. Baal was the all-controlling god over the crops and vegetation of the land. And by the way, Elijah prophesied to the Lord God Jehovah this devastating drought. That's why Ahab hated him, because he was a man of God. By the way, did you know that lightning was one of the weapons of Baal? And if he could do anything, certainly Baal, this god of the sun, this god of fire, certainly he could start a fire. So in verse 24, underline that phrase, call on the name of your God. Can your God, your idols, idols of popularity, yourself, can they help you? Or I will call on the name of the Lord because I know he can help me. It was a battle for supremacy, Baal versus God. It was literally a battle of the gods. Let me ask you two questions this evening, just by way of application. First of all, who do you serve? Do you serve yourself? Do you serve your God? Do you serve your flesh? Who do you serve? In your heart, answer that question. And then secondly, who's first in your life? Is God really first in your life? Or are you on the throne of your heart? Or is another idol on the throne of your heart? Are your children first? Maybe your spouse first? Is your job more important? Who's first in your life? Is God supreme? Look, the same battle they were waging was a battle of supremacy. You and I fight that same battle, but it's within our heart. Yeah, they fought this battle on Mount Calvary or Mount Carmel. You and I fight this battle within the recesses of our heart. Who do you serve and who is first in your life? Well, go down to verse number 23. In reality, this battle of the gods, it's really a prayer challenge. Did you know that only God can answer prayer? There's some of you this evening, you have physical needs, and I'm thinking of certain people that I'm praying for that may have cancer or some other physical need. Let me tell you something. The greatest thing we can do for one another is pray for each other. And here, the challenge that Elijah throws out to the prophets of Baal, it is a challenge of prayer. It's right in the text. Look at verse number 84. In verse number 24, excuse me. Then the Bible says, then you call on the name of your gods, and I will call on the name of the Lord, And the God who answers by fire, He is God. Did you circle the word call? It's found two times in verse 24. Call on the name of your gods, and I will call on the name of the Lord. Go down to verse 25. Now Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, choose one bull for yourselves and prepare it first, for you are many. Notice, here's the challenge, and call on the name of your God. Circle that phrase, call on the name of your God. And then verse 26, the Bible says, so they took the bull which was given them, they prepared it and called, circle that word. It means to cry. It even means to summons. It could be translated scream. They prepared it and called on the name of Baal. Notice, from morning till evening. I want you to notice as we read through this text, what was the results of praying to Baal? Would Baal answer their prayers? Well, look at verse 16. The Bible says in verse 16, so they took the bull which was given them and they prepared it. Notice, and called, they prayed on the name of Baal from morning till noon. Notice, underline this. O Baal, hear us. Same word translated, answer us in this passage. But the Bible says, but there was no answer. No one answered. Would you underline that in your Bible? And then they leaped about the altar which they had made. And then go down to verse number 29. And when midday was past, they prophesied until the time of the evening sacrifice. Look at it, underline it. But there was no voice. There it is again. Same repetitive phrase found in verse 26. There was no voice, no one answered, and this text adds this one little phrase, no one paid attention. Can you imagine praying in that fashion? No voice, no answer, no one paid attention. There was no smoke, no fire, no lightning. The altar was cold. The bull was unconsumed. The silence was deafening. No answer to their prayer. And that phrase, no answer, is found three times in reference to Baal. Well, I think we're understanding the futility of idols. Can you imagine praying to a tree stump? Jeremiah talks about cutting down wood, keeping our house warm, and then taking a piece of that wood and make it in an idol, and we put hands on it, put a nose on it. It can't smell. It can't handle anything. But yet we worship that piece of wood. And that's what the nation of Israel, that's what the people of God were doing. They were worshiping a false god. There was no answer, no fire. Well, as we begin to come to a closure tonight, go down and notice in verse 26, I want you to notice, man, they were dedicated, these Baal worshipers. They were very rigorous in their worship, in their religious activity around Baal. It could be even compared to a modern day religious service today. First of all, I want you to notice, man, they prayed a long time. 3 hours, and then 3 hours more. Verse 26, the Bible says, and they called on the name of Baal from evening till noon, saying, O Baal, hear us. And then they prayed even until the evening sacrifice. I think they were more dedicated than even most Christians. And we serve the Lord God, but they prayed a long time. They were very sincere in their prayer. They were very loud in their prayer. Notice in verse 26, They also worshiped with great enthusiasm. Verse 26 says, they leaped or they danced about the altar. You know, they were jumping all over trying to get Baal's attention. They worshiped with enthusiasm. By the way, they were serious about worship. They even mutilated their own bodies to find favor with Baal. Verse 28 says they cut themselves. So they cried aloud and cut themselves, as was their customs, with swords and lances. And the Bible says blood gushed out. In verse 29, notice, they even preached with great enthusiasm. Isn't that amazing? They even preached. Yeah, the Bible says in verse 29, they prophesied. I notice this word prophesy has a leaning toward raving. It's translated raved. And they preached all afternoon. Yeah, they had a worship service. But what was wrong? They were worshiping the wrong God, little g. We need to worship the Lord God. We need to pray. We need to sing. We need to preach. We need to serve the Lord God, Jehovah. Well, we come to the end of the story in verse 27 and 29, this first part of the story. And I want you to close with me and see that the emptiness, the hopelessness of the people. Do you see how empty they are? They're even mutilating their own bodies until blood gushed out. I want you to notice the sarcasm of Elijah. You know, the Bible has a lot of good humor, and sometimes sarcasm is a way of teaching in good humor about doctrine. In verse 27, the Bible says, and it was so at noon that Elijah mocked them. And he said, cry aloud, for he is a God. Either he's meditating or he's busy. I think the King James or one of the other translations says, he's in the bathroom. Oh, your God is so busy. He's in the outhouse and, he's meditating. He's on a journey, or perhaps he's sleeping and he must be awakened. So they cried aloud and cut themselves, as was their custom. And verse 29, and when midday was past, they prophesied until the time, notice, of the evening offering or the evening sacrifice, but there was no voice, no answer. No one paid attention. Well, let's wrap this up and we'll go home tonight. There's four lessons that maybe we can see from Elijah and this first section of the prophets of Baal. First of all, I want you to know that all religions are not the same. I think sometimes that, you know, we're so pure, you know, pluralistic in society, and we're polytheistic instead of monotheism. One God, the Lord God is one God. Hear, O Israel. Not all religions are the same. And I think we need to understand that it was Jesus who exclusively said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. Yes, it's through Jesus and Jesus alone. And then secondly, activity and, yeah, enthusiasm are not always signs of spirituality. Man, they put on a show around this altar as they were vigorously worshiping, but yet they were not worshiping the Lord God Jehovah. They were sincere in their worship. They were vibrant in their worship. They were zealous in their worship, but yet they weren't worshiping the Lord God. And then thirdly, I think sometimes our faith can be misplaced. You know, I think sometimes we emphasize that faith saves us and we should worship by faith. Listen to me carefully. It's the object of the faith that we put our faith in, the Lord Jesus Christ. For by grace are you saved through faith. Yes, it's faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah, faith can be misplaced. And then fourthly, as we close tonight, the faith you live, you know, the faith you live by better be good enough to die by. The truth of the matter is these people came down to it, and Baal was not enough. Baal did not come through. I hope today that you know Christ and Christ as your Savior, that He is the God who answers by fire, and He is God alone, and that you will worship Him. Hey, thank you for joining me in tonight's Bible study. This is just the first section of Mount Carmel, and I hope you see the emptiness of these idols. I hope next week, as we see this battle of prayer, answers to prayer. Oh my, next week's going to be very, very encouraging, because we're going to see God answer the prayer of Elijah. And that's where the victory is. The God of Elijah praying to the Lord God Jehovah. Thank you for being here, and we'll see you next week.